It is every American's birthright to squander a week on a leisurely pub crawl, descending and ascending the Florida Keys. Few places on the planet are home to so many picturesque and eccentric drinking establishments, all steeped in character and cherished by the locals. I'm Dave McBride, and I'll be your guide. The first stop is 48 miles and less than an hour's drive from Miami International Airport. The number of bars suggested for each day is not daunting. For example, on day one, the first bar is only 26 miles from the last bar, and the six bar stops are only a few minutes apart. One need not drink and run. Reset to island time. In Key West, the farthest distance between the bars suggested is about a mile, and most of the nine bars visited there over the course of 2 days are just a short stroll from one another. Take your time. On day one, our first stop is Alabama Jack's. As you descend on the highway from the mainland, detour off the main highway onto Card Sound Road to enter the Keys and to experience an iconic waterfront dive beloved in the Upper Keys. It's barely inside Monroe County. The opening time of 11 a.m. is more a guideline than a rule. It was crowded when we arrived at 10:45 in the morning. Mike, who says he has worked at the bar since he was 7 years old, says if somebody needs a drink when he arrives, he's open. Best conch fritters in the Keys, $8.50. It's on the water, in the mangroves, bikers, bikini babes, boaters, and fellow travelers on the road less traveled. Next, a few miles down the road is the Caribbean Club. This icon is at mile marker 104 on the bayside. All the bars heading down the Keys are either on the ocean side or the bayside. By the way, all the bars and their mile markers will be listed at the end of the video, so you can put your pen and notepad away until the end of the slideshow. Legend has it that the Caribbean Club was the location of the movie Key Largo. Fact is, an adjacent building next door that doesn't exist anymore played the exterior of the hotel in establishing shots. Bogie and Bacall were not on location. Lots of Bogart artifacts here. The actual boat used in The African Queen offers waterway rides a few miles away. A picturesque boat dockage and ramp is out back. This is a serious drinker's bar. No food, no credit cards. Virtually next door to Caribbean Club is Jimmy Johnson's Big Chill at Fisherman's Cove, Key Largo. It is just beyond a water sports outfitting business. It is also at mile marker 104 Bayside. It has a large waterfront tiki bar and restaurant deck. Locals declare the New York hand-tossed pizza the best in the Upper Keys. Jimmy Johnson, of the Miami Hurricanes and Dallas Cowboys and NFL commentary fame, has a home on nearby Tavernier and shows up from time to time. Lots of water sports available, including water jetpack. The thatched roof interior at the tiki bar is ringed with signed flip-flops of patrons. Not far down US 1 in Key Largo is the next stop, Pilot House. This is a short jog off US 1 to the left at 13 Seagate Boulevard. It's off mile marker 99.5 Oceanside. Pilot House touts a glass bottom bar. Glass panels allow for viewing through the bar deck beneath the bar stools. At night, illumination reveals fish, but the glass panels are opaque and reflective in daylight. Pilot House resides in a busy marina owned by the restaurant. Fresh fish caught locally. Regulars favor the stuffed mushrooms as an appetizer and the lobster mac as the main course. Next, we head back to US 1 and just across the road to Snook's Bayside. Mile marker 99.4 Bayside. The sign out on US 1 touts weddings. Nice sunset backdrop. The signature drink is the Snook Sunset, and another is called Rum Woo-Haw. My wife Anita gives the piña colada an 8 of 10. Good score. Bartender Larry from Boston calls the Snook's Indecision the most ordered entree. Spiny lobster tail and crab cake with béarnaise, $40. Yellowtail is also favored. Sam Adams is $4.75. Decent. Just 5 miles south and on the other side of the road is Snappers. Mile marker 94.5 Oceanside. It is a slight jog off the main road to the east at the Snappers sign. When we were there, a blues guitar player was performing on a boat at the dock in the small marina. He was very good. Says he once played with Buddy Guy. All fish are filleted in-house. Inserts to menu highlight daily dockside deliveries. They have a Sunday jazz brunch. It's all in Caribbean colors. Steps from the very nice Dove Creek Inn with sunrise sea views. That's a good place for a stopover. Keys residents may join the Turtle Club for bar and restaurant discounts. When asked if one is a turtle, the required response is, "You bet your sweet snapper I am." Snappers is the final stop on day number one. Day two begins with a visit to Wahoos at Whale Harbor, mile marker 83.5 Oceanside. Just south of Whale Harbor Channel, across the bridge from the perpetually crowded and spring breaky Postcard Inn, is Wahoos. The upstairs bar is as high as the tuna towers and flying bridges of the large charter fishing boats docked in the marina. In good weather, look out to sea from the bar to spy dozens of boats hugging a shallow sandbar for what has outlasted John D. McDonald's literary boat bash as the longest floating house party. Nice place to chill and look out to sea from a nice elevation. Just a mile south of Wahoos is the Isla Morada Beer Company and Tasting Room at mile marker 82.3 Oceanside. Craft brewing has been slow to come to the Upper Keys. One newcomer is the Isla Morada Beer Company. It's located smack on the ocean side of US 1, enticing travelers to stop and try the local brew. Anita likes the Sandbar Sunday. I like the Channel Marker IPA. Though brewing equipment is on view here, the brand is brewed currently in South Carolina. Bartender Gary retired last year and unretired to work here. He says he doesn't consider working in a craft beer tasting pub actual work. Lots of branded souvenirs and cornhole beanbag tossing for the easily bored. Growlers are available to go. Just a short distance south is the next stop, Lorelei Restaurant and Cabana Bar, mile marker 82 Bayside. Look for the giant mermaid. This is an uber-popular Isla Morada institution. Beach tables have terrific views, but on a busy day, the bar offers less downtime between empty glasses. A funky collection of oddball boats in the marina for hire. Separate waterfront seating area for those accompanied by dogs. In Key West, the place to be at sunset is Mallory Square. In Isla Morada, it's Lorelei. But it's not only a sundown destination. The bar opens at 7 a.m. Aces. Robbie's Marina is next, heading south. Apparently, every Google search on places to go in the Keys turns up Robbie's on the Bayside heading south at the end of a bridge at mile marker 77.5. That's the only way to explain the mob here. The gimmick is you can buy a bucket of guts or fish food and cause a tarpon feeding frenzy. One must negotiate a cluttered souvenir village of the sort at any Bahamian cruise port. The bar restaurant is the Hungry Tarpon, and there was a wait list at midday on a Sunday. We fled to a more laid-back locale. The feeding frenzy was fun, though. Now we head south 30 miles before the next stop at mile marker 47.7 Oceanside. Sunset Grill and Raw Bar is a treasure easy to miss. Leaving Marathon south, turn left into the Pigeon Key Info Center. That's where you buy the tickets for the trolley to Pigeon Key off the old 7 Mile Bridge. That tour is a 2.5 hour commitment. Better use of our bar time is to drive past the Info Center on Knights Key Boulevard till it ends at Kyle Way. Great views of the 7 Mile Bridge soaring overhead. The old bridge next to it starred in the climactic scene in True Lies. Bring a swimsuit. There's a full-size pool. Margaritaville radio on the speakers. Blink and miss the turn off US 1, and there's no turning again for 7 miles. That's the end of day two. Next comes Key West. Day three begins at the Hog's Breath Saloon, 400 Front Street, Key West. The main reason to visit the most famous bars in Key West is because everybody else does. Here you will breathe in the same air molecules exhaled by Ernest Hemingway, Robert Frost, Tennessee Williams, Jimmy Buffett, and assorted scallywags and presidents. Despite the new paint and the t-shirt annexes, these bars are real deal, true drinkers dive bars. Hog's Breath is a labyrinth of multiple bars a block from the north end of Duval Street. Trees grow through the canvas ceiling. As in many Key West bars, the walls are filled with license plates, stickers, and police and fire department badges from everywhere. Sit at the Raw Bar, where your bartender is Victor from the Bronx, who doubles as resident stand-up comic. Text your friends to watch you raise a glass to them on the webcam. A short walk away is Captain Tony's Saloon at 428 Green Street, Key West. Captain Tony is dead these 7 years, but t-shirts with his photo are still bestsellers and his life is legend. He dropped out of school in New Jersey to sell bootleg whiskey during Prohibition and traveled to Key West, where he was a boat captain, gun runner, and ladies' man before becoming proprietor of the iconic bar that was the original Sloppy Joe's. Jimmy Buffett wrote Last Mango in Paris about him, which begins, "I went down to Captain Tony's to get out of the heat. I heard a voice call out to me, 'Son, come have a seat.'" A huge tree in the center of the saloon disappears through the roof. Women's bras are stapled to the ceiling. Don't forget, when you leave, to walk out to the curb and, with your back to the building, try to toss a coin up over your shoulder into the mouth of the giant grouper above the Captain Tony's sign. It's a tradition. After a leisurely stroll south, we arrive at the Green Parrot Bar, 601 Whitehead Street, Key West, a landmark saloon with great blues on the jukebox and regular live music. It's off the beaten tourist track at Whitehead and Southard. On a steamy day in summer, I'm told the women's bathroom is the coldest place in town. Large rectangular bar. The author of America Walks Into a Bar ranked it the third best bar in America. Playboy wrote, "The management works tirelessly to avoid progress." Motto, no sniveling. Locals who drank here when Ernest Hemingway was in residence say, back then, the Parrot was known as the bar Hemingway walked past every day on his way to Sloppy Joe's. Which naturally brings us to Sloppy Joe's Bar, 201 Duval Street, Key West. This is the busiest tourist trap in Key West, but attendance is mandatory. Many order the Sloppy Joe from the menu, although the name has nothing to do with the sandwich. Ernest Hemingway encouraged the owner of his original haunt a block away, now Captain Tony's, to name it Sloppy Joe's after a bar he liked in Havana. According to legend, saying that Hemingway drank here is a colossal understatement. Live music abounds here. When we were there, the band featured a 9-year-old boy on vocals belting out "I Love Rock and Roll," brought down the house of Hemingway. Finish the day watching the sunset, and we will continue the Key West bar crawl tomorrow. Day 4 begins at Louis' Backyard, 700 Waddell Avenue, Key West. The bar out back is called After Deck and boasts a sea view. It's a short walk from the southernmost point, the selfie capital of Monroe County. Just over a mile from Sloppy Joe's on the far side of the island, so bar crawlers might consider a cab to return them to their starting point or start here. Off the typical tourist itinerary, so no crowds at lunch. A moderate hike or a quick cab ride away is another must-see drinking headquarters, Blue Heaven, 729 Thomas Street, Key West. One can still drink here with toes in the sand, but dust in summer has led to a bricking over of the yard. Anita was actually glad for bricks beneath her bar stool because the last time we visited here, her legs were bitten by sand fleas. The bartender contends the best no-see-em repellent is, in his words, crappy gin, which he also recommends for cleaning eyeglasses. There is better key lime pie in Key West, but no taller key lime pie. Now we walk a short distance to Duval Street and north to the corner of Caroline Street,
where we climb the stairs to the porch. 429 Caroline Street, Key West. Best artisanal beer and wine joint near the Duval Street hubbub. It's on the second floor of a stately old house. Comfy porch from which to spy on the passing parade. 70 wines by the bottle, 12 by the glass, 18 beers on tap. The original owner, Dr. Porter, is said to haunt the place by those who have seen him, who have been drinking. Our Key West crawl now takes us to the Marina District and to the Schooner Wharf Bar, 202 William Street, Key West. This is the definitive Key West Drinkers Dive Bar in a Michelin 5 stars kind of way. It's on the Key West Bite Marina. Mel Fisher's handprints and inscription in concrete on the ground reading "Today's the Day" reflect time loitering here before he found a $500 million in Spanish treasure. The great Michael McLeod plays here weekends. He once accused Toby Keith of stealing from his excellent song "Tourist Town Bar" to compose the hit "I Love This Bar," but lost the skirmish. You can stay here till 4 in the morning, after starting with breakfast at 7:30 a.m. A stone's throw from Schooner Wharf is the Conch Republic Seafood Company, 631 Green Street, Key West. On the boardwalk along the Key West Bite Marina, an enormous rectangular bar. I counted 42 others on bar stools at the time of our visit. View to the Key West Marina. Bar staff delivers with speed and personality. Good place to watch the fishing boats and the excursion boats returning from a day at sea. At a time of day, 4 to 7, which happily coincides with a buy one, get one happy hour. Your snapper on the plate may have been swimming in the Gulf 7 miles away hours before. And that's it for day 4. On day 5, we exit Key West and drive north just shy of 50 miles before our first stop, Faro Blanco Resort and Yacht Club, mile marker 48 Bayside. It's at a brand spanking new Hyatt. The bar overlooks a marina and restored lighthouse. Happy hour is 3 to 6. On the steamy day of our visit, the bartender, Paula, was eagerly anticipating imminent installation of ceiling fans. It opened February of 2015. The restored Faro Blanco light is no longer an official navigational aid. All photos here will include the lighthouse. When you are reviewing your trip later, you will remark, "There's the damn freaking lighthouse again." Just 6 miles past Faro Blanco is the Island Fish Company Antique Bar, mile marker 54 Bayside on Marathon Key. Spiny lobster can be viewed living under the docks. Grizzled dudes with sun-dyed skin, the color and texture of saddle leather, were at the bar well before lunchtime. Bartender Jenny explains that's because the bar opens at 8 a.m. As far as I know, it's the only tiki bar in the Keys that has a helicopter landing pad jutting out into the water. Only room for one chopper at a time, so for drinkers who are pilots, it's first come, first served. Next stop, Isla Mirada and Mirada Bay Beach Cafe, mile marker 81.6 Bayside, the prettiest bar-restaurant location in the Keys, in my opinion. There are bars inside and outside. Inside is best on a very hot day. Getting married? Say no more. A same-sex hitching was observed here not long ago. Shrimp ceviche and ahi tuna tartare are perfect for a hot afternoon. Check for beach parties hosted at each full moon. The gift shop is an Airstream trailer on the beach. Less than a mile away on the other side of US 1 is the Islander Resort, a Guy Harvey outpost. Mile marker 82.1 Oceanside. It has a beachside bar. Fish painter Guy Harvey added this iconic Keys resort to his growing necklace of tropical gems. The iconic sign on the overseas highway fairly screams Eisenhower era. Benjamin, the bartender at Mirada Bay, says he got married at the Islander, and the bartender at his wedding, Vern, became one of his best friends. He told us we should hear Vern laugh. So we came to Vern's bar at the Islander and made him laugh. It is a great one. On our sixth and final day of this Keys crawl, we begin with lunch at Lazy Days, mile marker 79.8 Oceanside. Oceanfront drinking and dining on two levels, 3 for $1 happy hour appetizers from 4 to 6. One of the many places that will cook what you catch. I ask bartender Aaron if he likes the hogfish sandwich. His reply, "What does it matter what I like? What if I like it and you don't?" Unable to craft a pithy rejoinder to Aaron's Socratic dialectic, I ordered the Merino burger. Less than 2 miles north is the Isla Mirada Fish Company. Mile marker 81.5 Bayside. Tarpon and jellyfish swim from the bay into a pond surrounded by a barside boardwalk. Diners toss food, triggering a tarpon feeding frenzy. Seems people everywhere toss food to tarpons. Being a tarpon seems an easy job in the Keys. Bartender Clark has an ID badge with his name followed by his work location, Bar. He said no one before me had ever put that together and called him Clark Bar. Then he admitted he was lying. The property also includes a large fish market. Across US 1 from Isla Mirada Fish Company on a side street is the Florida Keys Brewing Company, 200 Mirada Way, Oceanside. It's near mile marker 81.6. Locals say Mirada Way used to be called Industrial Street. Gentrification of this street brought artists, who included artisan brewers. The brewery beer tasting room opens at 1 p.m. Great collection for a range of tastes. The craft beers are brewed on the other side of the wall from the tasting room. Josh the barkeep told great stories about how Hurricane Wilma wrecked the Lorelei, Isla Mirada Fish Company, and Mirada Bay on the bayside for a year. He slept through part of that storm with his arms around a beer keg. The wall art is done in the medium of beer bottle caps. I love this place. And there is just one more place to stop on the way out of Key Largo, the final stop in the Keys crawl. Key Largo Fisheries Backyard Cafe, 1313 Ocean Bay Drive, Oceanside, near mile marker 99.4. This is not, in point of fact, a bar, although a hand will appear through a window presenting a variety of beers or wines. Here it is the fish that's the real deal. The fishing fleet delivers to the processing plant, where the fish are cut up and shipped internationally, except for the seafood that is handed into the adjoining kitchen, where it is relayed to you at the Backyard Cafe, aka Takeaway Cafe. All the beers seem to be $3.50. The only way to get fresher fish is to catch it. It's across the marina from the pilot house, where we stopped on the way south. Sadly, our tour ends here, just a few miles from the Florida mainland. But there are hundreds more Great Keys waterfront dives to visit up and down the overseas highway. That's thirsty work for another day.
And by the way, the location of the first scene in this video was Sundowners in Key Largo. And over my shoulder, just behind me, is the excellent Snappers Waterfront Saloon, also here in Key Largo. And I can promise you this, if you visit all the bars in this video, along the way, you're going to see a lot of other places. And you're going to say, holy cow, I've got to add that to my list of more places to see on my next trip to the Florida Keys.